We showed some promise. I think we made a lot of mistakes too. So it's good to get a base starting point to find out where we need to improve. And now we have an idea to see what our deficiencies are and then how to get better from that.
How hard was it to try to keep up with that hurry-up offense, the match-based spread?
I mean, I felt like we did pretty well. I know I didn't get too winded, but on maybe one or two series. And, you know, we credit that back to this summer with Coach Mack and the work he did conditioning us. And then during during fall camp, staying conditioned during it too. And so I felt good during the game.
Do you think Montana's offense helped prepare you some for what Cincinnati did?
Yeah, I think Cincinnati runs a lot of the same plays, and I think they run it a little better than Montana does. And from watching film this morning, it looks like they have a few better athletes too. And, you know, it's going to be a good matchup for us.
Prentiss, the coaches talked last week about some of the problems you guys had against spread offenses a year ago. When you watched on film, did you see significant improvement in what you guys are doing in secondary against a lot of those plays on the perimeter?
Yeah, I think we had a lot of significant improvement from last year. The main thing that stood out to me was our perimeter tackling. I think this week is going to be that much of a challenge for us, being that Cincinnati have a little bit more athletes on the team. So we're looking forward to have a big week of practice and just working on perimeter tackling this week also.
Bryce, you guys talked throughout the camp about bending but not breaking. I guess outside the 80-yard pass, is that pretty much what happened on Saturday? You guys gave up some of the short stuff but really were cautious not to let anything go deep?
Yes, sir. Well, yesterday when we met as a secondary, I think the offense had like 46 yards passing, like 80-some of that came from one big play. So I think we did a pretty good job of keeping everybody in front of us and making tackles on the perimeter.
Had some pick six action last year when R took this one back last Saturday night. What does that do to a defense? How does it charge you guys up?
It charges up a lot, man. When R made that play, I think I ran the fastest I could to the end zone, try to beat him to the end zone. It was big for me to even see him make that play because R's been through a lot. He's like a big brother to me on the team. So that was a big plus for me and for the team.
Daniel, can you just kind of talk about your transition in the defense, how comfortable you are at that position now, and how hard was it to make that switch?
You know, for me, it felt more natural playing defense. And so, you know, I'd like to say that it was the hardest thing I've ever done, but it seemed like it was the easiest. And just everything seemed to come more natural. Learning the defense seemed a lot easier than it was learning the offense, learning your steps, the techniques, and all those things. To me, that was 10 times easier than doing what I was doing on the offensive line.
Was there one guy that you really leaned on when you were making the transition that helped you out a lot?
Yeah, I mean, I leaned on everybody, and just because everybody has their own thing that they do the best. And you know, the one person I went to the most was probably Malik. And just, you know, I can see his talent, see it on film, and see how he does the techniques right and then when they work. And so I'd be like, hey, Malik, what should I do in this situation? How should I play this? And then I talked to Joe Ayers a lot, too, because Joe got a lot of playing time last year. And I was like, Joe, you know, when you see this, what are you reading? You know, how do you play this? You play it, you know, hard and physical. You play it a little bit loose and read, you know, just little things like that. And trying to learn everything from everybody.
Daniel, you guys play, I think, 9 defensive linemen kind of regularly. Mm-hmm. Did you guys have a set plan of how many snaps you wanted to get certain guys going in the game?
I think that Coach Thompson was just doing it based on his head count. And so, you know, I'd be in 3 or 4 plays, and, you know, I'd come out, get a drink of water or something, Mo would go in, Mo would come out, then Joe would go in. And so I don't think there was any set like, you know, Dan gets 25, Mo gets 25, Joe gets 25. I don't think it was anything like that. I think it was just how he felt and how he felt during the game.
Did you guys, you know, see anything else that would maybe change the rotation at all?
I don't think so. I thought Mo had a good game. I thought I played pretty well. I mean, all of us have room to improve, and I thought Joe showed some improvement too. And so I don't see anything that would change that.
Prince, you talked about the DBs meeting yesterday. Was Justin Coleman down at all about the big play? Did you guys have you know, as a veteran guy, tell him to keep his head up if that stuff happens or anything like that?
Justin Coleman wasn't down at all. He was around at practice making plays yesterday in the weight room going hard. So we watched the film. We corrected it. We asked him more questions than what we usually do. He was in there asking those same questions. So I think we're gonna he's gonna improve from game one to game two.
Did he come to you during the game? Do you have a lot of conversations with him during the game, trying to help him understand what's going on or settle down or anything like that?
Oh yes, sir. After every series, I kind of give him a question or two. I don't really like being in the players' head too much because I think they get some arousal and they get some out of their comfort level. So after every series or two, I come and ask him questions, ask him how he's feeling out there. He told him he was feeling good after that big play that Montana made. So that was a progress.
Chris, look like you guys playing a lot of nickel in preseason and Saturday night. Can you talk about being more flexible back there and kind of some of the things you could do in the secondary this year that maybe you couldn't last year?
I think we're a little bit more flexible because we have more depth. We have a lot of guys in the back end right now. Ed Gordon is getting the looks at the nickel right now, along with myself. So I think we're going to be playing a lot of more nickel throughout the season also.
Chris, how'd you feel? Brian Randolph did. I mean, it looked like he got a lot of time.
Oh yes, sir. Brian Randolph got a lot of time. He's a guy that roomed with me before the game. He was really excited to get out there, get his feet wet. Before the game, he was just telling me he's just waiting to touch somebody, make some type of contact. So I think once he got that contact down, I think he his comfort level came down, and I think he was just ready to play.
Coach Dooley said after the game that if Brian is able to come along, that might allow you to get back and play more corner. I mean, can you see it maybe heading that way later in the season?
I don't think I can give a call on that. I think Brian Randolph is going to continue to get better and better each week. Once he gets the study of how offense are trying to attack us as a defense, I think that playing time is going to improve for him also.
Chris, do you guys feel like you have a rotation pretty much set in secondary now, or is that going to keep rotating or changing throughout the season?
My opinion, I think it hasn't really set in yet. I think we're going to continue to rotate guys throughout the week until that one player, that one guy continues to show that they're the guy, in my opinion.
Daniel, no sacks the other night, but going in, that's the kind of offense where it's tough to get the quarterback to get rid of it fast. Is that frustrating as a defense when you know you just have to keep coming even though he's going to be getting rid of it quick?
You know, it is tough because the D-line, that's what we live for. I mean, we get teased in the spring and fall camp because you can't hit the quarterbacks with the green jerseys and everything. And you finally get in the real game, and, you know, I never even got a sniff of him. But it was good to see a bunch of the D-line get a few good hits on him. And so, you know, we can kind of say, well, that's nice. But, you know, the goal of every game is to get a bunch of sacks. And so not getting that, you know, it sucks, but I think we'll make improvements on it.
Is that the same thing you see on film from Cincinnati, emphasis on getting rid of them quickly?
A lot of it, yeah. In this last game, they ran the ball a lot, so we didn't have that many good looks at their passing situations. But I would assume that with the spread offense, it's all about getting the ball out quick and the hurry-up offense trying to get us winded. And so I would say it's going to be the same situation. But if we can affect the quarterback, then maybe Prentiss can get a nice pitch six and we'll go celebrate with him.
Andrew, are you worried you can't take too much from their film this week just because it seemed like they overmatched their opponent so much they might come out with something completely different this week?
No, I think every game there's something you can learn from it, whether it's, you know, if the center has this technique, if the guard has this technique, you know. You're always looking for something like, do they show the run? Do they show pass? Do you know which way they're line sliding? And so we're going to break down that film and try to find those things out. And then if we can, it's going to be a nice day on Saturday.
Chris, what's the hardest part about playing a spread offense?
The hardest part about playing a spread offense is you're sort of out-leveraged. They have a two-way go on you, and the ball is always in the perimeter. So you got to play sound technique ball. You got to be on the same page because if one guy chooses one direction and you both get out leverage or inside leverage, it can be a big pop.
Chris,